the old Corfield store. And yes, Robert Service was supposed to have worked in there.
And lived upstairs.
He lived upstairs. Yeah. Val and I used to climb up rickety stairs at the back.
Yeah. Over
and
the river.
His bed was still there.
Oh, for goodness sake.
We'd dare each other by the end because it was getting good.
No, well, you see, my uncle worked for Corfield and Courtney.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. When they lived there. But then they had a gas station.
Oh, did they?
Yeah.
So that would that have been before they were?
No, they
here?
Came from Duncan up to Courtney.
Oh, did they?
Yeah.
Probably.
Okay.
They were still there since the 50s, I think.
Were they?
Yeah. Very, very interesting.
Here we are back in Central Hall, first time this year. The next item is Chris Arnett again to introduce today's talk.
I'd also like to promote this new publication, Hot Off the Press, Agriculture, Our Island Tradition. It was produced by a committee of members from the Historical Society and the Farmers Institute under the very capable direction of oversight of Usha Rautenbach. And it's a really nice publication with a lot of great photos and a wonderful color reproduction of the one of the maps from the recent Salish Sea exhibit showing a retrospective of 100 years of farms on Salt Spring Island, 1901 to 2001. It's a great segue from the cover of this new publication. On the bottom here, we have a picture of the James family working on their farm on Parker Island. And it's important to note that when Farmers Institute was founded, you know, almost 110 years ago, it didn't just include Salt Spring Island, but included most of the Gulf Islands as well. And it's my great pleasure to introduce our next speaker, Mary Hogg, who is the granddaughter of Percival James, who was the father of four brothers who founded the James Seed Company. And this company began on Parker Island and moved to Salt Spring and then eventually to Cowichan Island, and at one time was the largest mail order seed company in Canada. So it's a very important part of our island history. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce Mary Hogg.
I better turn this thing on, I guess. There. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much, Chris. And good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. There's right off the start, I want to make one correction, that the James Seed Company was not the largest a seed company in the whole country, but it was the largest wholly Canadian seed company, meaning that they grew all their own seeds. I just want to make that point clear. The story of the James Seed Company covers four different farms, one on Parker Island, two on Salt Spring, and one at Cowichan Bay. My plan is to give a summary of each farm and then show the corresponding pictures. The company began on Parker Island In 1913, the island was bought by my grandfather, Percy James, who was a trained horticulturalist from England. At that time, the island was heavy virgin forest, and the family was faced with the enormous job of clearing a few acres near a bay facing Galliano Island. When the business began in 1914, the oldest son, Fred, was not eligible for military service. Jack, the second son, and my father joined the Navy, and Harry and Charles, or as he was known as Jim, were still too young. The seed company was therefore launched in the name of Fred J. James, co-founder and a graduate of the Arnold Arboretum at Harvard University. In the beginning, the seed stock was bought from reliable companies in England and the US. These were grown in trial plots to select the highest quality possible for seed. This practice was continued throughout the years to guarantee the product. Sometimes several years were required to stabilize new varieties. When my father developed the Salt Spring Sunrise tomato, it took him 10 years to perfect it. All types of seed for sale were grown by the company and guaranteed to be 100% Canadian. This became the company motto. James Seeds continued to expand on Parker Island until 1917, when the catalog listed 37 varieties of seed. At this time, they had to consider acquiring a larger farm, as no more suitable land was available on Parker Island. Also, the mail situation was very unsatisfactory for a catalog business. This shows the family. My father, Jack, is on the left, then Harry, and then my grandparents, Annie and Percival James, and Jim and Fred. There was also a daughter, Phyllis, who lived in Vancouver. This was Fred when he was studying at Harvard. Okay. This shows the house and some of the crops beginning in the little valley that was cleared. The boat in the foreground was the family boat that was used for mail and supplies to and from Galliano Island. This is the picture that's on the front of the little booklet that's just come out, showing the horses and plowing on the island. Sometimes more help was also available from the other islands. This was one of the very large Douglas fir trees that was on the island. It was 16 feet in circumference and was 290 years old. And this was in about 1917, before they moved. The bay facing Galliano was down to the left, and the little valley continued up to the right to another bay that was on the north end of the island. Parker Island was sold, and the family moved to Barnsbury Island on Salt Spring Island. This was the former home of Reverend Wilson, and now the Salt Spring Island Golf Club. As a matter of interest, Parker Island was sold in 1917 for $4,500. I hate to think what it is today. The climate and soil on the Gulf Islands and southern Vancouver Island are considered ideal for seed production in Canada. Spring rains, together with fertilizer and manure, provide good plant growth, while warm, dry summers encourage bloom and seed development without irrigation. The islands are also more isolated for purity of seed. At Barnsbury, 40 acres were planted in vegetables and flowers, including 22 varieties of sweet peas. By 1923, the catalog listed 55 sweet peas, one of the most popular of all flowers. The price of a packet of seed at that time was 5 or 10 cents. As evident in the photographs, the seed business in those years was extremely labor-intensive, requiring many workers as well as family. Many jobs were done manually, including starting the seed, transplanting in the fields, hoeing and weeding. The seed was either hand-picked or machine-cut and thrashed. All seed then had to be cleaned by machine to separate seed from chaff or pulp. This required special sieves of every size, from the dust-like lobelia seed to beans, etc. Before packaging, the seed had to be tested for germination. There are government regulations for minimum germination, but the James always insisted that they have the highest percentage possible. During the fall and winter, the seed was hand-packaged by family and employees. Again, specially designed seed measures were used, some minute in size. A 1 ounce measure contains approximately 250,000 lobelia seeds. Today, packaging is done by computerized machines by the large seed companies. The catalog also had to be updated and mailed each year. On the display table over here are some old glass photo negatives taken by Fred for catalog pictures. Finally, in the early spring, all mail orders had to be filled and shipped. This is Jim on a Fordson tractor, which was the first tractor that was brought onto Salt Spring Island. It was in use for many years on the other farms. It would be in the early 20s. This was thrashing pea seed at Barnsbury. The thrashing machines and other big equipment was motored off the... This was a Beeman tractor, a small tractor that was used for cultivating, and it was run by a belt off the tractor. There's an interesting little story here. The commercial belting was manufactured by the by a belt company in Toronto, the Linton Belt Company. And in later years, Fred James married one of the Linton daughters. I think it was not all business in Toronto. This was a little planter. I've never seen a picture or another planter like it anywhere. It was a tube planter consisting of two tubes. I think you can see them there. One for the plant and one for water. At the base of it was a metal mouth which opened to allow the plants to be put in the soil. After the plant and water were put in, then the machine was removed. It was not all work and no play. The family loved picnics. And every Sunday was a day off, so they often went picnicking. This, I think, was at Walker Hook. You'll note the white flannels and the dresses. The Coast Guard would have a fit if they saw this picture today. This was in a family speed launch, and this was also at Walker Hook. We're going on to Fernwood. By 1923, the company once again required more land and moved to the 150-acre Fernwood farm. The name of the company now became Fred J. James and Brothers. Fernwood Farm extended from the waterfront to North End Road, west of Fernwood Wharf, Fernwood Road. It also included the marsh area on the lower side of North End Road. In 10 years, the business had grown from 2 to 3 acres to 150 acres. 152 varieties of seed were sold throughout North America and Europe by mail order. My sister Valerie Watt, who I know many of you know, and myself were born while the family was at Fernwood Farm. Our youngest sister, Audrey Bennett, was born at Cowichan and now lives in Kelowna. This picture shows the faithful old Fordson tractor plowing on Fernwood Farm. This was taken from the waterfront and looking up to the buildings on the top of the hill. This was one of the Lang houses where the Langs and the Case Morrises lived. In the foreground, I think that's lettuce going to seed. In the background, there are two little buildings there, which I'm told were built by the people who owned the farm before the Langs. This is the old house on Fernwood Farm, which is still standing, but I'm told it's in real disrepair. The James family also lived in this house. It was built by the Langs. This is a field of sweet peas and other flowers looking down towards Wallace Island and Galliano. You can see the extent of the farm in that direction. These were potatoes growing in the marsh area. The deep soil of the marsh was ideal for growing root crops. It was also very useful for growing crops that required isolation from the rest of the farm. There were huge crops of beet and mangold were grown in the marsh. It wasn't all done by tractor. The good old horses were still used for some cultivating and seeding. This was our father Jack on the tractor with discs and harrow behind. These were used to pulverize the soil before planting. This was the Beeman tractor again, which was used to cultivate between the rows. The rows had to be kept free of weeds through hand hoeing. It was very important in the seed business to prevent weeds from growing and contaminating the other seed. This was looking on the other side of Fernwood Farm, looking down towards Galliano again, and Fernwood Road would be to the right. These were various vegetable crops. These were anemones, which were grown to be shipped as flowers to the florists in Vancouver. They were a beautiful assortment of colors, And they were picked in bud and packed in boxes with moss. They were a beautiful sight. These were thousands of sweet pea seedlings being grown in cold frames before planting out in the fields. This I put in because I know that many of you knew my mother, Dorothy James. She came to Salt Spring as a bride in 1922. And she took a great interest in the company. She and our father came back to Salt Spring in 1960 to retire here, and they continued active in the horticultural affairs. The two other little monkeys are Val and myself. The fox fur, I'm sure, is frowned on today, but it was quite fashionable at that time. By 1930, the business had once again outgrown the farm at Fernwood, and more acreage was required to handle the large demand for seed and for the segregation of more varieties. Also, the CPR boat service was limited to 3 days a week. The decision was therefore made to buy the 300-acre Corfield farm at the head of Cowichan Bay. Relocating a seed business is an enormous undertaking. At Cowichan, a large new seed house and office was built, plus family houses. Three large barns were updated for seed cleaning and storage, and a 100-foot greenhouse was constructed. In the meantime, all the operations had to be completed on Salt Spring, and ploughing, etc., started at Cowichan. The seed and all the equipment was gradually moved to Cowichan, and more machinery bought for the larger acreage. This whole operation took close to 2 years. The name of the company now became James Canadian Seeds Limited. By 1932, almost 1 million seed packages were filled for mail order and store displays. This number grew steadily every year. As many as 50 workers were required in the fields and for seed packaging and mailing. This provided many jobs during the Depression years. During World War II, the company procured large overseas contracts for vegetable seeds. Huge shipments of radish and cucumber seeds were sent to Russia at the time they were allies. Seed for England included onion, carrot, peas, and cabbage. In the Mediterranean area, the military used flower seeds, especially portulaca, to camouflage the roofs of buildings. The end of the war marked the end of the seed business, of the James business. Companies in other countries began flooding the market with cheaper seed. Higher BC labor costs and the philosophy of growing 100% Canadian seeds made it impossible to continue, and the company ended operations. Today, all the large seed companies buy under worldwide contracts. This shows the extent of the Cowichan farm, looking down to Cowichan Bay with Salt Spring Island in the background. On the left, you see part of a group of maple trees. This was quite a large grove, and they were 300 and 400 years old. Unfortunately, I don't think any of them are left today. This was a field of carrot going in a field closer to the bay. I think that's my father in the field. In the immediate background, the logging railway, which goes down to the ship port in Cowichan Bay. This was a wartime field of vegetables with the grove of maples in the background again. These are tomatoes ready for picking and thrashing. This was a special tomato thrashing machine, which was invented by both Jim and Harry, who were mechanical geniuses. The tomatoes were picked and fed into the hopper on top, and then the juice and pulp were they were taken by a chute into large hoppers on the field. In these large hoppers, they were allowed to ferment for several days. This fermentation helped to prevent seed-borne disease and also separate the seed from the pulp. After fermentation, the pulp and the juice was all washed away, and then the seed put in large sieves and put out to dry. These were heaps of vegetable marrow ready for processing for seed. And these were citrons. I don't know how many of you have seen citrons growing. They are used for cake fruit and rind. This was a field of squash, again, I think, for overseas seed. This shows a large field of tomatoes and a crew out pruning them. They were pruned, they were always grown on the ground and pruned so that the sunlight could get out the fruit. This was the 100-foot greenhouse where all the seed was grown for young plants before putting out in the fields. There were always quite a number of women working in the greenhouse in the spring to plant the seed and to prick out the seedlings. This is the group of Canadian women working in the fields during the war, since the men were not around. Valerie and I both worked with this group in the summer, and I think we received the princely sum of 25 cents an hour. This was, these were onions for seed. As most of you probably know, many roots are biennials, and so it requires 2 years before you get seed. This was rolling portulaca after it had been picked. The plants, the ripened plants, were cut and put onto long pieces of heavy paper or canvas. Then they were rolled to break open the seed pods before thrashing. Each year, the company had exhibits in both Vancouver and Victoria exhibition. This was the Victoria exhibition in, I think it was about 1932 or 33. The small seeds were displayed in glass jars, and the larger ones in small sacks along the front. The vases of flowers were all grown, the flowers were all grown on the farm. That's it? Okay. Okay. Yes, they were displayed in both the Vancouver and the Victoria exhibitions. Vancouver at that time also had a winter fair in which they displayed. I think that's my talk for today. Thank you very much. These were not used after, I guess, 1945. And so they've long gone, unfortunately. Any other questions?
At the back, please. Did you carry on saving seed yourself, just with your family, after this company shut down?
I have done a little bit. The only one that I used to save was the Salt Spring tomato seed, Salt Spring Island tomato. And that eventually, the strain eventually went, and so I don't save it anymore. My grandfather developed the Mrs. P.T. James clematis, which I think some of you probably know. It is available from the nurseries.
When did the company cease operation again?
1945. Yes. They went out of business. Due to the situation with the importation of seeds, etc., they're grown all over the world. And so it didn't really fit. On the table here, I've made a little sketch of Parker Island showing where the farm was and where the house was. And from, there is a little space there showing where the house was. It's marked as ruins now on the charts. That's a very good question. As a matter of fact, we were talking about this morning. I have no idea why he picked Parker Island. Well, I guess maybe in 1913 they were. I guess he was looking for a place to start some seed growing. But why in the world was Parker Island? I have no idea.
Was it isolated?
Yeah.
That's one consideration.
And
pardon?
When you go to Pemberton, where they grow the potatoes, there's all that stuff about it being isolated.
That's right. And I think that was one of the reasons that they did choose islands, was that it was isolated for purity of seed.
I believe that's true of the Ruckles when they grew seed potatoes as well.
Yes,
both,
I'm sure.
Both for isolation of the variety and the,
yes.
the minimizing the chance of transmittal of disease.
Yes. The farm at Cowichan was a very beautiful place when all the flowers were in bloom, and many visitors came from Victoria and various places to wander through the fields.
Oh, one more than last one.
I think appropriate to end. I'm Dan Jason of Salt Spring Seeds. Some of you know me for sure, but the James Seed Company inspired me to get going with the philosophy of isolation and the great growing conditions here on Salt Spring. And I started the seed company in 1985, 1986 maybe, and I'm using the same screens that I got from the James Seed Company, and Salt Spring Sunrise Tomato is still going on, and I've been going for 19 years now, and I don't intend to stop. Right. And we have 6,000 people on our mailing list, and our methods are probably even more labor intensive than.
Thank you for coming.
I'd like to thank Mary for a very informative talk, and history continues to repeat itself by the sound of it. So thanks very much. Thank you.